Content warning. Racism, unnecessary surgery, and ants. Ants! Ants!
Action!
Excitement!
Romance!
Thrills and chills!
Swords and sorcery!
Rockets and ray guns!
A dizzying panoply of the strange and impossible from the darkest depths of the human imagination!
What mad universe encompasses such tales as these?
Join us as we bear witness to the sweeping sprawl of all the history that never was and all the futures that could yet be. It's adventure as you like it on What Mad Universe.
Just what makes that little old ant think he'll move that rubber tree plant? Anyone knows an ant can't move a rubber tree plant.
But he's got high hopes. He's got high hopes. He's got.
After he cut the white cotton that covered him from head to foot, he took it off and could see that his enemy was indeed a giant insect, probably a giant ant, with a huge chest above an abdomen that was just as huge, with two huge antennae that were used as arms and two jointed legs. The antennae, the secondary legs, six in all, looked atrophied, but were still in a rudimentary state. A black shell covered the body and limbs, as well as the head, like crab's armor. But in spite of the drastic modifications that an extraordinary heredity, or maybe refined art, had given to this frightful insect, its general form was still there and left no possible doubt as to its nature. It was a monstrous ant, of the genus Atobarbara, as tall as an average man and reduced to the four usual limbs of a mammal. But it was still an ant, a reasoning, evil, and even learned ant, and with a head as big as its abdomen, endowed with strong mandibles, two faceted eyes, and a frontal eye with three triangular cilli that looked like they had been particularly damaged by the gunshot they had just suffered. Spiridon the Mute, 1907, by André Laurie. Hi, welcome to What Mad Universe, the podcast that explores the roots of genre fiction through its early pulp years. I'm Philip Rice, and with me as always is Adam Prosser.
Hello.
Today we were going to be covering The Machine to Kill by Phantom of the Opera creator Gaston Leroux, but we ran into some difficulty finding full translation. We've sorted it out, and that episode is still forthcoming, but since we only had a week to prepare this new episode this time, I thought of doing one on a short novel that I just discovered 2 weeks ago, actually. It instantly caught my attention by its very strange premise. Spiridon the Mute is about a Frenchman named Aristide Cordat, who recently graduated medical school. He goes on a trip to a sparsely populated Italian island, where he finds a colony of intelligent ants ruled over by a large humanoid ant named Spiridon. After some initial conflict, to put it lightly, he takes Spiridon back to Paris to become a world-class surgeon, disguised as a human man. Bizarre. The novel was written by André Laurie, a pseudonym of Pascal Grousset. How would you pronounce that?
Grousset. Pascal Grousset.
Pascal Grousset. Thank you, Adam. He had a very interesting life in his own right. He initially studied medicine before going into journalism and politics. He was involved in radical newspapers. He was a lifelong socialist, though never thought of himself as a specific leftist ideology like communism or anarchy. He was involved in a duel with then-Emperor Pierre Napoleon Bonaparte in 1870, which resulted in the death of one of his...
Correction. He wasn't the emperor. He was the nephew of the emperor.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
I think it would have been a bigger deal if he'd been in a duel with the emperor. Yeah.
Fair enough. Yeah, sorry. I saw Napoleon Bonaparte, and I guess I skipped some info there. Right.
And also, this is Napoleon III, not the
Pierre Napoleon. Yeah. Pierre Napoleon, yeah. But Bonaparte shot his second in the duel. He was sentenced to 6 months in prison. Later on, during the Paris Commune, he was elected as a member of the Executive Committee and delegate for external affairs. After the fall of the Commune, he was arrested and deported to New Caledonia, where he escaped, moving to Sydney, San Francisco, New York, and London, where he lived as a French teacher. After an amnesty was granted by the French government in 1880, he returned to France, and later once again became a politician, and held elected office until his death. He was a great supporter of physical fitness and encouraged sport without winners or losers. You said here he came in, he clashed with Pierre de Coubertin?
Coubertin, yeah. I think we come back to that, but yeah, again, this guy's got a lot of interesting things, but just to give you an overview. For
He wrote a number of books and novels under a few pen names, including Philippe Darrow, Tiburce Moret, and Leopold Viry. As André Laurie, he collaborated, that's heavy quotes, with Jules Verne. In fact, two of his novels that Laurie wrote, The Bell, Begum's Millions and The Southern Star, were just rewritten and published under Verne's name. So wasn't so much a collaboration as somebody changed his novels and published it under a different name.
Yet another thing we'll go back.
Yeah, he disowned both subsequently. His third collaboration with Verne was The Salvage from the Cynthia, which was published under both their names. Though scholars believe Laurie was the sole writer, with Verne only doing validation work, whatever that means. I guess editing. Being seen as Verne's ghostwriter gained him some notoriety, but it meant he had to live in Verne's shadow as a writer. He eventually branched out in his own direction, writing novels about bringing the moon closer to the Earth, to mine its materials easier. A lost civilization story called The Secret of the Magician, about a steam-powered flying island, and The Crystal City, which is about a surviving society of Atlanteans. But his most acclaimed, and definitely his most unusual work, from what I can see, was Spiridon.
Yeah. Well, I mean, some of his other stuff sounds pretty wild, too, but
Yeah, but this is, like, you know, you see, like, other lost civilization stories and other, you know, Atlantis stories, but
right.
I haven't come across any about a surgeon ant.
It is definitely one of these sort of things where you go, how did he come up with that exactly?
Yeah.
What was he on?
Well, the probably the ant elixir that heals
you. Yeah, exactly. the crucial elixirs that let the ants perform brilliant surgeries, which is in this story. But yeah, it's a very strange, and I mean, this is a function of early, not quite 19th century, it's very early 20th century, but that storytelling, you know, the way they told stories was different and often a bit more discursive and stuff. So the pacing is weird on top of everything else. And the way he approaches the story is pretty strange, right?
Yeah, like, I had no idea where it was going, because Spiridon dies like partway, like
two-thirds
of the way into it. And yeah. I thought, like, it looked like he was trying to prove that everything that he said was true, because, you know, all his evidence was gone, his house burned down and stuff. But then Spiridon is resurrected, and so that's
right.
Like, yeah, I had no idea where the story was going, honestly.
Yeah, but he's also, and I mean, this is a function of Jules Verne and a few others as well, where it's just, he's almost more interested in the scientific discovery than a plot, like a dramatic plot, right?
Yeah.
Like he'll literally spend pages and pages talking about how they, you know, got everyone together to have a whole, and all the debates between scientists of the time. And how they would you know, form rivalries. There's this one guy, what's his name, Bordier, who immediately becomes his arch nemesis because he doubts everything that he says, right? But yeah, it is very weirdly not so much weirdly paced as framed in a strange way, right?
Yeah.
The first third is him on an adventure, flashing back to his adventure in Italy, how he discovered Spiridon in the first place. Then it's Spiridon coming to Paris and becoming...
Yeah, Spiridon is disguised as a Chinese nobleman, a baron... Tessimorna, which is not a Chinese name. He's also described as
well, he says Asian. He doesn't specify Chinese, I guess.
They say Chinese a couple times, but that seems to be like a catch-all for Asian. I don't know how this disguise is supposed to work, because he has fake arms and legs over his real ones.
Yeah.
And a constructed wax head over his real head. So it would be really creepy. I mean, a non-moving wax face. I mean, I know people were racist at the time and would have thought, you know, a Asian person looked weird anyway, but like, you know, Asian people still move.
Right. Well, and he had a, like he describes the head as being particularly large. So it's like, okay, so he, you know, and an ant head, of course, would be,
it has the mandibles. It describes very large mandibles on him. So I guess the head's on top of his own head, like a...
But
he's the same height as a man, so I don't know how this is supposed to work. It's very odd. It's very odd that it would fool anybody.
Well, to be fair, Bourdieu...
They do think he looks strange, but...
Yeah, they kind of... He gets close, and he figures out that he's wearing a disguise. But
but it wouldn't fool anybody for a second.
I could almost buy... Okay, just to play devil's advocate, I could almost buy that because he's mostly seen in, like, an operating theater and in places where, like, he's, you know, he's seen from a bit of a distance. So I could almost buy that. I don't think do they have scenes where he has him over to a party or anything? I can't remember. Did he?
Not socially, I don't think. He does go to like pharmacists and stuff to get his chemicals.
Right.
And he gives them notes because he can't speak. Which we'll get into, but.
Yeah, he is Spiridon the Mute.
Yeah.
But yes, it's well. I mean, I don't know.
Suspension of disbelief at a certain point, but it's a very odd thing to.
Right. Well, to be fair, he doesn't pull it off for very long.
No.
It doesn't last that long that he's walking around as an ant disguised as a human, but yeah.
Yeah, a friend of the show, Will Staples, when I described this plot, said it sounded like a Doom Patrol story.
Yeah, it does. It has, you know, considering what we were saying, like, oh, we read William S. Burroughs last week, so this week we're tackling a very normal story about an ant who disguises himself as a human in 19th century Paris, you know, one of those
And
things.
Becomes a world-class surgeon.
And becomes a world-class surgeon. Well, just to rewind a bit, because it's one of these, you know, it's funny, it is in some ways reminiscent of something like Tarzan. You know, there were definitely novel, and I know, I guess Tarzan would have been after this? Yeah, Tarzan would have
Around
later.
The same time, I think, Tarzan.
I believe Tarzan's like 1907, 1908, like around then. So I think this does actually beat Tarzan. But there were a couple of stories around that time that were sort of a scientist or an explorer finds something strange in the forgotten corner of the world, some kind of entity, some kind of person who's unusual, brings them to society, and they can't really fit into our society. And, you know, there's a contrast, and usually it destroys them, and it's an indictment of our
society. I think there
were
a few, I haven't read them yet, but a few about talking apes and things like that from around this time.
Yeah. So there
one about an ape who becomes the prime minister of Britain. So I want to seek that one out.
Yeah. So if you're an ant, you can become a world-class surgeon, but if you're an ape, you can become the prime minister. So there you go. So yeah, it's got that kind of, and again, maybe this was more unique at the time, but that sort of outsider come to our society vibe, although he's weirdly unsympathetic to Spiridon. He doesn't take, the introduction describes it as like, well, he's destroyed by, you know, humanity's vices and so on and so forth. And I don't know. Is he really? Like
he's kind of just, he has a different morality than we do. Like he doesn't consider, well, he doesn't have a morality. He just wants to he's protect got his own species. Yeah,
he's
but
got
like,
his own morality, but it's just.
But
very,
he doesn't. Yeah. He doesn't think twice about killing somebody who's even annoying to him.
Right, and I or, don't like, even. Yeah. Yeah, I don't. Yeah, he literally says at one point, he's like, well, we're going to face, you know, we're going to face some. Oh, it was the Italian family who I guess we can talk about in a minute. But there were people who dislike him. And he says, well, they don't bother me. I can just kill them. And
yeah.
And Cordat, Aristide Cordat, the doctor who takes him, or the scientist explorer doctor who takes him home, says, no, you can't just go around killing people. But it is actually interesting to me that Cordat is weirdly amoral too. Didn't you think that? I almost
a little, yeah.
I almost felt like they were trying to draw a parallel between Cordat and Spiridon in that sense, because Cordat literally goes, "Well, we'll take him home and he'll become a world class," like, which is an insane plan to begin with.
Yeah.
But just
oh,
but
it should be noted he's already shown to be a really good surgeon. So
right.
Like, but he doesn't also, just come up with that out of nowhere.
Oh, yeah, yeah. No, he knew that this guy had all these. But and he's trying to get the secret of Spiridon's,
method.
Magic elixirs and
yeah,
and
yeah, yeah.
Techniques.
There's an elixir that can make surgeries. First of all, it eliminates pain.
Right.
It makes it so blood doesn't drip out. And it just makes surgeries like you can fix somebody in less than 5 minutes, you know.
Right, it's like a really good epidural that hadn't been discovered in 1905.
Yeah,
and
hasn't.
Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, they do some incredible surgery on people who are considered hopeless at the time. Someone with tuberculosis.
Yeah.
Someone with who is blind, and he restores their sight. But again, though, it's treated in a sort of a way where Cordat doesn't think about the ramifications at all of bringing a giant ant among Paris society. And this is an ant that, to be clear, Cordat meets Spiridon because he goes, you know, he meets this Italian, his ship is shipwrecked. He meets an Italian family who says, oh, we lost our son. He went over the ridge there into the wasteland where nobody goes. He sets out to see if he can find him. He passes out. There's some chemicals, which, again, this is something Spiridon has. He has chemicals that can knock people out. He wakes up on an operating table, having his arm cut open and I guess, operated on and
experimented on.
Yeah, autopsied by Spiridon. Spiridon, who's able to communicate by touching people's hands and tapping out in Morse code languages like Italian.
No, it's like electric pulses.
Yeah, I was a little unclear on that. Is he literally communicating?
I think it's supposed to be electric pulses.
But it's
Morse
code
in Italian.
Right? Yeah, he's telling him in Morse code, which Cordat can understand instantly well enough. So I guess he's both a sailor and a scientist, but still, that's pretty crazy. There's no barrier to communication despite this bizarre way of discussing
I found, I know this is a translation to English, but I found Spiridon's dialogue a little strange for what he is. Like, he uses slang at certain points, like he calls a corpse a stiff.
A stiff, yeah, right.
It's just kind of casual for, like, a alien, like, he's not alien, literally, but like something alien to humanity.
Well, it makes a certain amount of sense. But they do talk about how he'd heard Italian, presumably from the other people he'd autopsied over the years.
And, fair enough, yeah.
That was kind of what he was getting it from. And I mean, he's a very intelligent to the point where he can, you know, grasp a language very quickly and so forth, and as on top of everything else.
It should be noted, when I went into, when I read descriptions of it, that he's like from a colony of ants, I figured they'd be like him or something, but...
Right.
They're actually like literally small ants, and they treat their king with like they're they seem to be more intelligent than ants, but like they just look like ants, they treat their king or chosen leader with the elixir in a certain way, which causes them to grow into a larger form.
Right. And I feel like in most ways they are regular ants. They also grow wheat, which is supposed to have restorative properties, although that gets dropped pretty fast. But Yeah, it in many ways, I don't feel like the ants themselves are any more, because other ants act in these parasocial ways as well, or eusocial ways, rather.
They sort of follow the leader. I don't think on an individual level they're intelligent.
Right, they're treated, but even like real world ants have that sort of, they do these very sophisticated things acting as a colony. And in this case, though, because they treat one ant who's the chosen leader, and it's strange that it's like, maybe it's because, again, this is a 19th century or early 20th century book, it's, you know, that they didn't have it be a female ant, but to me it would have been more logical if this was their queen, but apparently
but the queens aren't actually the leaders, right? They just give birth to the colony.
True. I mean, but so,
So like he's this seems to be like the protector, the benefactor for the colony.
Right.
Rather than like, he doesn't give birth to them. Though they do describe like his family line goes back to met the ancient Phoenicians and who named their family Spiridon, so that's where the name comes from.
Right. And it's in an ancient Phoenician tower. There's some vaguely implied connection between the ancient Phoenicians who built the tower, which is where the ants live, although it's ruined now. So they feed one of their
ants. Yeah, I looked up what Spiridon means. It's Greek for basket, so I don't know why that was chosen.
Okay. And this is Italy anyway, so who knows?
I don't know. There's also gold in the tower that Spiridon doesn't really care about. Yeah.
Which is
gold and diamonds and
kind of a plot point going back to what I'm saying though, like Cordat wakes up being like literally operated on by Spiridon. He's able to basically escape with some of the, he finds some of the treasure that's been stowed in this tower, takes it back. So here's where he starts to feel a little dodgy, and I'm not sure to what degree Laurie Grusat wanted this to be clear, because he doesn't tell the Italians. First of all, he knows that their son was, he sees the body of what he immediately understands to be their son, who has been, again, torn apart and autopsied by Spiridon. He keeps all this treasure that he found without mentioning it to them. He basically keeps them in the dark and sort of, he seems very shifty and calculating to me. He comes off that way. And then when Spiridon shows up looking for them, trying to gas them again, he shoots Spiridon in the face, knocks him out, and then and uses some of his own elixirs, if I recall correctly, to heal him. But once that's been sorted out, it becomes, he starts to say basically, hey, you know what? You're a really genius surgeon. Want to come back to Paris and become a genius surgeon? And like, they patch it up really quick. Not just the Spiridon, but Cordat. They get over what's happening fast.
There's a line, like it goes from like him capturing Spiridon to the next chapter where he says, on the other hand, you know, he had a point. Like he was just trying to protect himself, and, you know.
Right. And I mean, it's admirable in a way, but he doesn't ever touch on the fact that he's taking a murderous giant ant back to Paris with him in the hopes of extracting value from him, basically.
It's also odd because I think just bringing the ant and showing him off would make him famous too. Like,
right.
He doesn't have to go through a charade. I don't know.
Well, yeah, exactly. So it's almost like I'm trying to do it in such a way that once, like, he never says this, but you know, he keeps trying to get the secret of all the elixirs and all those techniques out of Spiridon, and he never says, well, and then when I found it all out, maybe I'll knock him off, right? He never says that, but that's the most logical outcome of keeping him a secret, rather than just saying, I found a giant ant who knows all this stuff. It's a very weird attitude that he takes, and again, he's got the same amorality that Spiridon himself seems to have. And I feel like that must have been partly intentional, but it is surprisingly treated in a very off cavalier manner. They don't delve into it, you know?
Yeah, and it's not something that's dwelled on.
And Cordat is not, like, he doesn't face some kind of punishment for what he's done either. It's like, I mean, he sort of does in the fact that Spiridon dies. And by the end, he's literally, Spiridon has died, but as you said, they managed to resurrect him using his elixir. and prove.
But he has
everyone,
no memory. He doesn't know who he is. Right. So he doesn't know how to make the elixir anymore.
Right.
They end up finding the remnants of his ant colony, which had been blown up by the Italian people as revenge. But they find like some remaining ants, so they can reestablish a colony. But like that's not
right.
Getting the elixir, so it ends with the elixir being maybe a few years off. So that's an interesting.
Yeah. Or even if they're gonna like, it's possible they could never find it. But
yeah,
but what's interesting about the end is that then suddenly there's more of a warm family feeling, like Spiridon's going to be raised by humans now, and Cordai is now like bringing him into his family and treating him in a more human way. So it's almost
and
like,
names his son Spiridon.
Yeah, he names his son Spiridon, and it almost seems like he's dropped the "I'm going to be a mercenary scientist and just treat you like a human, and that's going to be like a fresh start for all of us." That's kind of an interesting way to interpret it. Again, whether it was really
also interesting seeing Spiridon at the end without his memories. He's sort of melancholy and he just stares out the window all the time.
Yeah.
And when he sees the other ants of his colony, he's momentarily sort of perks up a bit, but sort of forgets about them once they're shut away.
Right. So there's kind of an implication that maybe he'll relearn who he was and so forth and get it back. But
is that a good
no...
thing though? He might just kill a lot of people. I don't know.
Well, I mean, maybe it's more like he'll learn his natural, ant abilities rather than remember who he was. And again, if you're sort of, it's the old thing about, you know, if a murderer loses his memory, he gets raised by, you know, some kind people somewhere. And even if he remembers who he was, he's a new person now. His old memories will make him feel, you know, we'll be in a different way. So I feel like that's kind of the message there. It's like he needs to go through a period of understanding humanity, essentially. Which
it's
in
still
itself,
very strange.
Yeah, it's very weird. And in and of itself, it's kind of like there's a very colonial mindset to everything of like, well, European science will come and take you out of your... And even with the human characters, we mentioned the Italians... they're treated very, the novel doesn't treat them very well, in my opinion, because they lost their son, and then Cordat comes out kind of taking advantage of them. They eventually come to Paris. They're the ones who kill Spiridon, and it's because, you know, they understand that he killed their son and the brother of the woman, the girl who's kind of set up as a love interest for Cordat, but she's obsessed with vendetta against Spiridon.
Yeah.
And she literally brings a stiletto. It's
like a bad Simpsons plot later on where Sideshow Bob has a family of Italian, or when he moves to Italy and gets a family and his son keeps saying vendetta.
Yeah.
Well, just reminded me of that, like weird Italian stereotypes.
Everything they do there is an Italian stereotype in this
novel,
she
carries around a knife.
Yeah, stiletto.
Yeah.
No less. Which is again is an Italian weapon. So it's sort of this, well, I'm free to just take advantage of them. And again, he never sort of says, "Hey, you know, by the way, there's treasure in that tower and I'm going to share some of it with you because you helped me."
He does give them some money, but
eventually, like, well, then as he's gone home and then he learns they've destroyed the tower because they were somewhat logically, it's like, if this is killing people, we should knock it over.
But before that, he had sent some money to them.
Right.
To pay for a few things, but like not like, you know.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's crumbs compared to like, they find a fortune in gold and jewels in the tower. And then he's angry at them for knocking over the tower because there was all this wealth in it. It's like, well, dude,
you
were
didn't
just
tell
trying
them
to...
And you were keeping all this, you know, like, you didn't let them know what was going on and then get mad when they do the logical thing.
Right, exactly. And then does he tell them at that point that there was all this wealth in there? And then they're kind of like, oh, we're so stupid. Oh, we're sorry we did that. It's like, you didn't tell us. You were going to, as far as we can tell, you were never going to tell them that there was a treasure. You were just going to extract
and
it yourself.
The girl Pia kills Spiridon, then herself. Very dramatically, again, like Italian stereotypes, like a full-on opera, you know. Yeah. And then the father gets so distressed by this that he falls to his death.
Right.
Yeah. So, very, like you said, they're not treated well by the text.
And but again, it is, it's like they're the ones who act emotionally and, I mean, it's over the top, but they act like human beings. And Cordat comes off as a weirdo who is almost sociopathic in some ways. I do want to talk about, just quickly, you know, we can come back to that, but I did want to talk about the life of Grusat, because he is really interesting, as we talked about. All this interesting stuff happened. For people who may not know, there was a period briefly in 1871 when Paris was under the control of a socialist, basically because of all the wars that were going on and the capture of the, we mentioned Napoleon III. He was captured by the Prussians and they basically got rid of, for much of the 19th century, and I'm not an expert, but I know that there was kind of a back and forth between Napoleon declaring himself emperor and an attempt to, you know, restart the Republic, which had been started after
revolution.
Anyway, yeah. So there was about 100 years of real turmoil in France, capped off in some ways by during a period of turmoil. This is sounding familiar. People grabbed hold of Paris and took over and turned it into a socialist leaderless commune. Which was kind of an inspiration for years afterwards as just a place where, you know, there were no, it was a purely democratic, purely socialist leadership. And it's, in fact, the basis for Les Miserables. That's what's being depicted in Les Mis, was the few months where they had control of Paris. They were eventually crushed by the Republican troops that came back. What's interesting?
Yeah, anyway, Orwell spoke positively of it. Like it's a big thing in like Karl Marx leftist circles.
Yeah, yeah, Karl Marx literally went to the commune and saw it and was encouraged by it. And I mean, during the Russian Revolution 50 years later, Lenin was basically trying to recreate it in his own way. Of course, it wouldn't have been exactly the same. But he supposedly he had a giant celebration. And he was not a celebratory guy, but the day that the communist Bolshevik government in Russia outlasted the Paris Commune, he had a big party for everyone, because that meant we've done it, we've beat the Paris Commune, we surpassed their record, essentially, without being
crushed.
And
then built an authoritarian regime that
yes,
killed a lot of people.
But nevertheless, he was inspired by it. So anyway, Grusat was there. Victor Hugo, again, who wrote Les Miserables, was there in the Paris Commune. So they probably knew each other, even though what I'm seeing doesn't specifically mention it. But they were probably at the very least friends or acquaintances, because they were both journalists in the Paris Commune at that time. And
Grusat was a politician. He was outright elected during that period.
Right. Yes, he was one of the elected people who worked there. He was essentially, you know, minister for foreign affairs, which never came into play because they were literally under siege the entire time. But he had actual political role. And then so he had to escape, and of course they were looking for him for a while after the Paris Commune got crushed. He did eventually. There was an amnesty declared. Was it at this point they exported him to New Caledonia, or was it after he was involved in the thing with Napoleon's nephew?
It was after the commune collapsed. So he was he was sent to Caledonia and
which is in the Pacific, by the way.
Lived in various places.
Yeah, French colony in the Pacific. So you get the sense of, you know, in this novel where he sailed around and was shipwrecked, that even though it was Italy, that was something not completely unlike what Grusat had experienced. But anyway, they eventually announced an amnesty, so he was able to come back to France and became more of focused on his writing. As we said,
but he was a politician. He was in office till he died. Like we said, he focused on physical fitness, which he had apparently gotten interested in when he was in America, in New York. And he was focused on encouraging sport that didn't have that wasn't competitive. So it would just focus on the best athletes, but, you know, sort of generally good for everybody.
I think it was the idea he wanted to encourage team sports and so on. And apparently open air, which was a big deal as opposed to, I guess, inside an arcadium. And I mean, it's actually interesting. And they mentioned he clashed with, Pierre de Coubertin, who is the modern father of the Olympics. He revived them in the, I believe, 1890 something, very, very tail end of the 19th century. That was when they launched the new Olympics. And, Coubertin was, you know, he was a monarchist. He was like a really reactionary, old school, fire breathing, right wing guy. And he was literally saying, like, well, this'll genetically pick out the most powerful, important people. You know, we'll see how the aristocracy is better physically than the poor people. He literally didn't want women to compete in the Olympics. He was very adamant about that. He said it ages them unnaturally. and Grousset was literally just completely the opposite of that. He said no. And he made they bring up the point that he was talking about, which I think is actually quite accurate, which is that, you know, it encourages a mindset. When you focus on sport, it's, you know, it's nationalistic. It encourages the idea of, well, you're the best, and if you're number two, you're nothing. The Bobby, the legend of Ricky Bobby saying, if you're not first, you're last. You know, that attitude, and it's actually true, that has had a big impact on our society. And that was something Grousset was trying to push back against, which as the intro to this book points out, you know, that culminated with, you know, the Nazi Olympics in 1937.
Right,
they embraced it very happily, all the ideas, which apparently Coubertin then kind of went, oops. So he did regret it a little when he saw that. But,
this also plays in some of the themes of the book, because the ant colony is very eugenics-based.
Right.
Spiridon talks about his morality, and he wants to improve the species, and he's very... he talks about how, you know, you let your sick and lame and whatnot go around, and you don't, cull to create the best and the best.
Right.
So you get some pushback from that sort of attitude in this.
Yeah, I think that was, like I say, in that sense, Corday is clearly, you know, as you hear the depictions of the novel, you think, oh, it's going to be about a poor, innocent soul who comes to our, you know, poor, our nasty old civilization, and it gets destroyed. It's like, no, he's pretty brutal. I mean, he's an innocent in a sense, but he's, you know, the innocent of wild nature, of just, you know, the law of the jungle
might makes right sort of thing.
And how, you know, that is logical. That would be how an ant would think if it could communicate and think like a human. Because it's just like, oh, that's useless. Okay, kill it. You know, that kind of attitude.
It's interesting comparing it with another book about giant ants. First Man in the Moon by H.G. Wells, which has a similar eugenics thing. But Wells was pro-eugenics, so it's... It's an interesting contrast. They were both socialists, but obviously very on different spectrums on that regard.
Yeah, I think I might have mentioned this in an earlier show. I really like the Once and Future King series by T.H. White. That's best. The Sword in the Stone is the best known, the first book of it, but it's a whole series of books about King Arthur and Merlin. And the final book, he turns Arthur into an ant and has him visit an ant colony. And there's a famous scene where... you know, when he goes to see the ant colony, and it's held up as literally the model of everything, the embodiment of everything we should avoid as humans. And when you see the sign over the ant colony, it says, everything that is not forbidden is compulsory. Everything that is not compulsory is forbidden. So you can see how ants are often held up as kind of, the thing to avoid among humans. You're saying H.G. Wells was pro-eugenics, but this was someone who was a socialist. They don't say it as much, but I tend to think that Grousset was probably an anarchist.
He never outright identified with a philosophy, but from what I can tell from all this information, he seems more on the quote libertarian socialist end of things.
An anarchist, and he it's as was T.H. White, and so ants are often held up in that sense. It seems like they have that commonality of ants being seen as sort of the idea of regimented control.
A very clockwork society.
Although it's interesting that he doesn't get into the ant society as much in Spiridon. Like, it's an individual who has this ideology, but they don't talk about, you know, like, Spiridon doesn't talk about how he wants to enslave the Earth or anything, or, you know, or make everyone operate. Like, they don't get into the sociological
construction. He wants to get knowledge from humanity, but not give away any of his knowledge, so...
Right.
There is some idea of a competition there, but it's not an outright, you know, he wants to enslave humanity.
Yeah, it's very weird because, you know, there's ways in which you can see Spiridon as a cautionary tale, and there's ways in which you could see him as an inspirational figure. It's a very amoral book, as we say. It's very interesting that he's almost asking us to just, you know, this just happened. He's thinking more in terms of what would an ant be like if it could talk to humans? than almost any other aspect of, like, he's not necessarily making a broad political satire or anything.
Reminded of a Simpsons joke where they end an episode by saying, maybe there is no moral, it's just a bunch of stuff that happened.
Well, I mean, like I say, there's definitely interesting
there's
ideas.
Themes,
But
it's funny, I guess it's not didactic. It doesn't tell you what to think.
Well, and it's just surprising, given his history and his politics, that he wouldn't be using... That seems like a prime, a prime idea for studying, for doing a satirical examination of humanity, and he doesn't take the bait in that regard at all, really.
I read the book before I read the introduction or anything about his life. I knew vaguely there was something about the Paris Commune, but otherwise I had no idea about his politics, and it actually really surprised me reading the introduction about all his beliefs and, you know, stuff he did. It's strange. See it going back, looking at, you know, you can see connections and stuff, but you wouldn't immediately come up with that reading the book.
Yeah. Well, as I think we've talked about this before, but, you know, in the late 19th, early 20th century, socialism was often associated as with H.G. Wells, it was often associated very heavily with the scientific mindset, as it were. And so there was a large, and again, you can kind of tie that into what happened under the Bolsheviks in Russia. Like, there was this attitude of, like, no, we have to be unemotional, unsentimental, just we are men of science, we are evolved men, we're better than, you know, the bourgeois sentimentality. And so in that you can kind of see a tie into that, maybe, that it's about, you know, just being a man of science and not leaving behind the emotions of the past. It's a bit of a
you
stretch,
could also read it as there. A critique of that, though,
because yeah, exactly, yeah. And when we were talked about RUR, you know, we had some of the same stuff there, right? The robots being the unemotional humans that were, in some ways, that socialism was trying to create, or some types of socialism thought was the future of humanity, and it was a warning against that. So you can see how there were people in the socialist side who were like, well, yeah, but we can't lose our humanity. We can't, you know, we can't reinvent the wheel when it comes to humanity. And I would put that roughly in this same category, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting in that regard. And then we did mention Jules Verne, just to go into that a little bit more. He submitted these manuscripts for a couple of books, and Jules Verne literally took them and rewrote them, which is wild. Because Jules Verne was a well-established author at that point, right?
Yeah.
And the first book that he submitted, I couldn't find much about the second one, but this book, Begum's Fortune, or Begum's Millions, depending on how you translate it, was interesting because it's apparently the first Jules Verne book to have cynicism about the advancement of technology. Because usually Verne was very much, yes, science will advance and will be better.
He did do a dystopian future novel that was never released in his time, I think.
But didn't that come later, though? Like, this.
I'm not sure.
Later on, I think he embraced some more. I'm not going to say his ideology didn't shift over the years, but I think it's telling that this book written by this guy whose political background we've discussed has a bit more cynicism towards the advancement of technology and portrays these two cities, both built by someone who inherited all this money, one of which is a land of, you know, freedom and supposedly and ideology, and one of which, and that's French, even though they're both built apparently in the US. One of them's French, and it's built on liberté, égalité, fraternité, and the other one is built by Germans, and it's a nightmarish, oppressive regime based on, and this is interesting, genetic superiority and eugenics. And this is, again, this is written in the 19th century, but it disturbingly foreshadows a lot of the Nazi regime. And you've got to think, you know, Grousset saw the Paris Commune crushed partly by the Prussians, i.e. Germans. And in some ways, the bitterness towards Germany coming out of that, or Germans coming from that novel, feels like it's from Grousset, even though it was rewritten by Verne. And just that whole fascist ideology being held up as evil, that feels more like it's from Grousset. It's hard to say what was Grousset and what was Verne, but given what a break it is with some of the stuff Verne's done, you know, that actually sounds like it may be Grousset's novel as much as it is Verne's.
Grousset did disown that one, but I don't know. I haven't read it, so I have no idea.
Yeah. Well, I'm willing to bet it's a matter of if somebody took your manuscript and rewrote it, you'd want to disown it as well. And I'm sure that, like, for instance, it's been mentioned there was some racist stuff in the book about, you know, like it was still very, you know, oh, well, the white man will be superior to, like, they bring in Chinese immigrants to build the city and then kick them out because they thought Chinese people might stir up too much trouble or something like that. And that feels like maybe that's the kind of thing. I don't know. I don't want to point a finger at Jules Verne and say he was racist, but he was a 19th century European.
Yeah.
And it feels like if anyone's going to, you know, side that way, you know, Grousset's politics were probably less on that end than Verne's. But who's to say? We can't say with any certainty who wrote what at this remove 150 years later. And but that it's just very interesting that that was there. But yeah, and he wrote two books that Jules Verne rewrote, and it was I think it was the editor's ploy to sort of make it sell more because Jules Verne was better known. So
yeah. I didn't mention where I came across this book because it was on the I can't remember which website in particular, but I was looking up French pulp characters, and this one came up a couple times and on a few sites, and this giant ant surgeon, it blew me away. Like, it's such a weird concept, as we've discussed. I had to seek it out, and I found there's an ebook readily available that I instantly got and read in a weekend. So it's a regular length. It's like 220 pages, I guess. It's a quick read, so I would recommend this one if you want something just weird and interesting.
I mean, as I say, I'm actually, you know, it's such a strange book, and it's certainly interesting. It was a little frustrating, and part of it is going to be blamed on the fact that it's a translation from French to English. I thought that the translation was a little bit awkward. Maybe the version I read was more awkward than yours, but
I think we read the same one, so
probably, but it didn't feel very elegant in some of its prose.
That's usually not what I'm looking for in this kind of book. Sure. So I guess I'm
right. I mean, you've got to point it in, but I do think it is weird that Grousset or Laurie kept going. He felt the need to reiterate several things over and over again. He tells the story of how he found the ant like three different times over the course of the novel. Once he's literally flashes back to it and you're told it, then he tells it to the police, and then he tells it to all the scientists who have come to see him operate on him at the end. And he keeps retelling this and describing it as an ant.
There's a large section where all the evidence is, because his house gets burned down in the fight between Spiridon and the Italians. And so all the evidence is lost. There's Spiridon's body, but like nobody believes anything, and they think sorry, I've forgotten his name already.
Cordat.
It's Cordat who killed the. We didn't mention there's a rival surgeon who ends up kidnapping Spiridon to get the secrets out of him, and Spiridon escapes and murders the guy savagely.
Yeah. So again.
Cordat's wanted for that. And they think he's been faking all the surgeries and stuff, and he has to prove his innocence. And he can't find any of the elixir, but he eventually realizes that that there was another lab that they initially set up. So he finds some intact elixir in there and uses that to prove his innocence in front of a big auditorium of surgeons and scientists. And there's a bit where they're going to try to bring Spiridon back to life, which they do, but they ask if there's an expert on insects in the crowd, and there is, and he comes out and starts explaining things, and there's this very strange part where it's
literally like right at the climax, and they've stopped the story to explain more about ants, which we've and how he's a giant ant, which we knew. Thank you. We get it. We don't need.
Like
this.
I said, like I would recommend this on a as a curiosity more than like a, but I found it really interesting. So.
Oh yeah, like story wise, there's interesting ideas for sure. His storytelling is. He's more like a very didactic college lecturer than he wants to keep explaining everything and delving, which is that was fairly common at the time. I know H.G. Wells.
Yeah, but I found it kind of interesting. It fit the story in some ways. Like it fit the.
I mean, it makes sense.
Nature of the thing.
Well, it makes sense that he would be explaining everything to the scientists, and you know, of course. But as a story. You know, a modern writer would go, okay, can we find a way to skip over this? Because we already know, the audience already knows this stuff. We don't have to go into it again, right? So, anyway, I'm just sorry to be, you know, to be down on it. And it is short and it's fairly breezy and, like, it's such a wild book and so interesting in so many ways. I just, you know, in terms of a book read for pleasure, I wouldn't highly recommend that to people generally. Unless you just...
I didn't say highly. I just said...
yeah.
Seek it out if this interests you.
Yeah. So anyway, it is interesting.
The ants appear to be marching down to the ground to get out of the rain, so it's time to say goodbye. We've been Philip Rice, Myrmidon Splendifica, and Adam Prosser, Formidicae Magnifica. We want to give thanks to Alex Ross, Engineeris Producere, and Jack Feerick, Musicalis Thematica.
Yes, and just a reminder, if you enjoy the show, you might want to join in the Hive Mind at our Patreons to help us afford the hosting and recording costs. If you do so, you'll be able to listen to the show early and get a bunch of other stuff like comics and illustrations. Just look under Philip Rice or Adam Prosser at patreon.com or go to neversleepsnetwork.com/series/what-mad-universe for the links. You can also get this podcast via iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, or your podcaster of choice, as well as on YouTube via Philip's channel. And if you enjoy it, please leave a review. It would also help us if you'd spread the word about What Mad Universe. Tell your friends or link to us on social media. Philip's on Twitter as spearhafok_ with an F as in Frank. I'm Prankster36, and the show itself is WMU Podcast.
So until next time, long live the Queen.